Sometimes you can release all of your stress if you just give God a hallelujah. Can you say amen? Some things may never change in your life, but if your perspective change about the things in your life, you'll live your life at a higher level. Can you say amen? God is good all the time, and all the time the Lord is good. Let's give God a great big hand clap of praise. Come on. Come on, don't you? Don't be short on God. Don't patty cake with God. Amen. We've been doing this series, You Turn My Whole World Around, putting the oral word back into our faith. That word is repentance. Can you say amen? God is just so good. Amen. Every now and then you ought to think about what he has already done for you. Come on, say amen. In this materialistic world that teaches us to be consumers every day, we ought to think about what God has already done. I don't need another anything. God has already blessed me. Come on, say amen. If he don't do anything else, he's already done enough. Quit being discontent in your spirit and learn to be content with some things that you have. Can you say amen? Don't worry yourself into a grave. Shout yourself happy. Come on, say amen. Amen. God is good today. Amen. Amen. I want to remind us that we do have a survey. I hope everybody got that survey. Amen. Amen. You got it. You're going to survey somebody else, not yourself. 5 or 10 people. Can you say amen? I'm just excited about everything we're doing for this church anniversary. We're going to do it in a big way because we are thankful. Thankful. I said we are thankful. Amen. For 54 years. Can you say amen? Amen. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. I want to focus on this passage in the book of Mark. Can you say amen? Second chapter starting at verse 13. Amen. Let's stand together for the reading of the word of God. Can you say amen? I just love the word of God. Amen. Amen. Just the reading of it is enough. Mark chapter 2, verse 13. Are you there? If not, say wait. I heard one wait. Mark is an action gospel. We believe that he wrote as a result of his relationship with the Apostle Peter. He gives us a gospel that really demonstrates that Jesus is a wonder worker. Can you say amen? Verse 13. Then he went out again by the sea. And all the multitude came to him, and he taught them. And as he passed by, He saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, that's Matthew, sitting at the tax office. And he said to him, follow me. You got to know that when he left this Roman office, this Roman job, he was never going to receive it again. It was a well-paying job. He decided at that very moment to follow Jesus. So he arose and followed him. Now it happened as he was dining in Levi's house that many tax collectors and sinners also sat together with Jesus and his disciples. For there were many, and they followed him. When the scribes and the Pharisees saw him eating with the tax collectors and sinners, they said to him, or to his disciples, how is it that he eats and drinks with tax collectors and sinners? When Jesus heard it, he said to them, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Father, we thank you today that you're God. We praise you for who you are. We thank you for those who have taken the pledge today. We pledge to serve you. We pledge to lift up your name. We pledge to carry the bloodstained banner forward in the future. We pledge to give you the glory. We thank you, O God, that you are God all by yourself. Pray, O God, that you would live through us as we keep this pledge to you in the name of Jesus. How we thank you today for your word. You know, O God, we need you. You understand that even now that you are the illuminator of this text. So we give ourselves to you. Feed us until we want no more. Speak to our hearts. Speak to our lives in a practical way. Help us to understand that we are following you. We desire to accomplish whatever you place in our heart. Bless every heart today. Bless their families. Bless their faith. Bless their finances. And bless their future. This I pray in Jesus' name. Come on, shout amen. Amen. You know, I want to talk about an opportunity to turn it around. I'm still right there. An opportunity to turn it around. Can you say amen? History has recorded some of the greatest turnarounds in life. The Union Army, the Civil War, was outmaneuvered by a West Point graduate by the name of Robert E. Lee. The South was undermanned and undergunned, but yet they had outperformed the North. President Lincoln, in his search for a new general, for a new commander of the Northern Army, found this washed out military soldier by the name of Ulysses S. Grant. He was known for his drinking. He had a slight drinking problem. He had some early marks against him for disciplinary action. Now a leader of the Illinois Volunteers, he had been called by the president, pressed into service to be a general. His whole aim was to pursue General Lee and to bring the Civil War to a close. This was a great turnaround in the Civil War. Winston Churchill was another who led the British people amidst the resignation of their prime minister. He inspired a beleaguered nation to not to surrender, to refuse defeat, to not to compromise peace, but help inspire this British nation to resistance, especially during this difficult days of the early part of World War II, where the British stood alone as the European nation against that one who they opposed by the name of Adolf Hitler. Churchill's speech in Harrow, England, says to us, all of us, never give in, never give up. He led the British nation to victory. This was a great turnaround in human history. There are those who have turned lives around against all odds, against all hope, with little support, they have done and demonstrated big things for people who have felt that their lives were hopeless. You remember that young Harriet Tubman who led 300 souls from the brutal oppression of slavery down the sweet tracks of the Underground Railroad to freedom land. She turned lives around with her courage and with her determination. Though these are great turnarounds, the Gospel of Mark presents to us a surprising turnaround of the salvation of soul of all of human history. This turnaround is more than a matter of force. It's more than a matter of will. It's more than a matter of courage. Many have experienced it because they have heard the call of God on their life. They have heard the call of repentance and have turned from sin back to God. Have I got a witness here? What is this thing called repentance? Repentance in the New Testament, the word for repentance means to change one's mind. The Pauline phrase could serve as a definition for this term repentance. You turn to God from idols to serve a true and living God. That's 1 Thessalonians 1:9. And all of us ought to be able to say, we now serve a true and living God. Repentance is that initial response which a person must take in order to become a Christian. If you are a Christian, you have made a U-turn in life. Are you with me here? It also knows a response which Christians must make repeatedly throughout this pilgrimage, repeatedly throughout this journey. Even the best Christian does not live a perfect life. Are you with me here? And every now and then, God shows us where we need to turn around, where we need to repent, where we need to turn toward Him. Repentance is thus a metaphor for faith. Faith is my personal trust in God. And repentance pictures that trust as turning to God. Where life has failed me, I've turned to God. Where I've been bruised, I've turned to God. Where I've fallen on my face, I've turned to God. Where I've stepped in the mud, I've turned to God. Where I've done things that I'm ashamed of, I've turned to God. Are you with me here? Repentance. There are those who are sorry for sin. We call it penitence or condition. There are those who admit to sin. We call that confession. There are those who are resolved to give up their sin. We call that a resolution. However, taken together or singular, they do not comprise repentance. For repentance speaks a response made specifically to God. It is not enough to turn away from my sins. One must turn to God. Have I got a witness? The gospel preacher or the preacher of the gospel must direct the attention of the listener away from himself, including his sin, toward Christ. In Acts, the attempts to convince people, there were no attempts to convince people of their sin. They always attempted to convince them of what God had achieved in Christ Jesus. And if anybody's been saved in this place, you know God has achieved some things in Christ Jesus. That God has achieved victory over death, hell, and the grave in Christ Jesus. That when you came to Calvary, when you laid your burdens down, your eyes became open, your soul became saved. God made a difference in your life. Calvary has done something for you. It has done something for me. He's achieved something. I've got victory. I'm not a victim. I've got victory over all of my problems, victory over all of my pain, victory over everything in my life because Christ is in my heart. Critics can question what God can do in any life. Some folk wonder why you're in the church today, because they know how you cut up in the world. They're trying to figure out why you going to church right now, because they know what kind of rascal you used to be, what kind of hell you used to raise, how you used to get yours and get all of yours to the morning or the break of dawn. Come on, talk to me up in here. They're wondering, why are you sitting in church today? Have I got a witness? How dare we criticize? How dare we complain? When you look at the text, there are the Pharisees who are criticizing Jesus and wondering, why are you sitting with tax collectors and sinners? Have I got somebody? Who were these critics? Pharisees. Not all were teachers of the law, but pious Jews.
although some no doubt were godly, but most of them who had a conflict with Jesus were hypocrites, envious, rigid, and formalistic. They had a form of godliness, but no power thereof. Have I got somebody? They criticized Jesus for hanging out with the outcasts, the scourge, the scoundrels, the shiftless, the roughnecks of society, thug life, hoochie mamas, gangsters, sit at the table and ate with Jesus. Touch somebody and say yes. Their self-righteous spirit emerged. How is it you can sit with those folk fresh out of TDC, been fresh off the corner and just dropped the crack pipe? Now they sitting with you. Are you with me up in here? Those who are self-righteous do not realize their need for salvation through repentance. They're always trying to act like they got it all right. But I stopped by to tell you, ain't nobody all right. Have I got somebody? We've got to admit to the fact that we made some mistakes. We've done some things that we regret, but God can do something about it. This spirit of self-righteousness can consume the church, explaining why we are so judgmental. We try to act like we ain't never made a mistake. We try to act like we ain't never did nothing wrong. Try to act like we ain't never turned the lights down low. Come on, talk to me. Try to act like we ain't never turned no corners we got any regrets for. We never been in no smoke-filled rooms. You know how we act sometimes. Then folk find out what we've done. Oh, come on with me. That explains why we are seen as hypocrites. We try to act like we ain't never done nothing. But can I tell you something? Somebody is always looking. They saw you over at the club. They saw you on the download. They saw you when you were turning that corner. They saw you when you went in that door. And now they saying you ain't nothing but a hypocrite. Trying to act like you ain't never done nothing. Trying to act like you don't need to repent. Trying to act like all you can spotlight is somebody else's sin. You need to turn the light on yourself. Just clap and flick the light on. And the person you need to see is you, standing in the mirror for what you have done. And Lord, forgive me of my sins. Is there anybody up in here with me? Jesus, being the master teacher that he is, takes the criticism and turns it into a teaching moment. Uses the question to teach the guests about himself and the spiritual work he has done. He starts with a comparison of being a physician. Does anybody know he's the great physician? He's the lover of my soul. Have I got a witness here? And what Christ does, he gives us four things that we need to understand about God's attitude toward the outcast, the scourged, the shiftless, you know, that thug life. What's God's attitude about the broken and despised? What's God's attitude about a sinner? Can I give you four things about his attitude? Number one, God desires mercy for you. Now, in this verse, it's not included, but when you cross-reference it with Matthew 9:13, he'll tell you, I desire mercy and not sacrifice. Have I got somebody? See, what God is saying, that he wants to apply mercy to all of your mess. Have I got somebody? He wants to apply mercy to all of your wounds. He wants to apply mercy to all of your hurts. Are you with me here? He's the great physician. He knows what's wrong with your life. God is not looking for you to do any sacrifice. He wants to rub some balm into your wound. You do know there's a balm in Gilead, enough to make the wounded whole. He wants to apply it to your life. The idea is he wants to cover your sins and mine. I've made a mess. You've made a mess. We've done some things that are messed up in our life. But God says, I'm sending a great physician who can heal you of your sin-sick soul. Number two, what's your attitude about sinners, God? God calls you in your brokenness. Verse 17. God knows where you are. You can fool everybody else, but you can't fool God. Have I got a witness here? You can look all dressed up and be all messed up on the inside. Have I got somebody? God knows just who you are. The idea here, when they called them sinners, it meant that they were notorious sinners. with guns in their pocket, knives, and they were notorious sinners. They had no regard for the law of God. They were unfamiliar with anything in the church. They were roughnecks. They were hoochie mamas that were sitting with Jesus Christ. He knew just who they were. The third thing about God's attitude, God sees your need for wellness. Are you with me here? Praise God, he sees it. Because some of us try to act like we're not broken. We try to act like nothing is wrong because we think everybody else got it together. So we're going to do what everybody else does, act like we got it all together. Have I got somebody? But when you translate this word sickness, it means disease. That's really what it means. But thank God there's a doctor in the house. Are you with me here? For every hurt I have, Jesus is a doctor. For every pain I feel, Jesus is a doctor. For every worry I got, Jesus is a doctor. For everything that stresses me out, Jesus is a doctor. For every broken place in my body, Jesus is a doctor. For everything that has gone wrong, Jesus is a doctor. For all of my diseases. See, sickness means something is out of line with your physical body. All of us can relate to this because all of us have been sick, whether of a minor illness or a major illness. And your body was out of line. And a physician had to come along, maybe with some medicine, to get your body back in line. But the same thing can happen to our spiritual lives. They can get out of line. Have I got somebody? You got to call a physician to come along to get your spiritual life back in line. And the physician to call, his name is Jesus. Touch your neighbor to the left and say, Jesus. Touch your neighbor to the right and say, Jesus. If you need a doctor, Jesus is the one for you. God desires, number four, his attitude is he desires to have. With a sinner, with the broken, with the outcast, with the despised, with the scourge of society. He wants a relationship. So they walked in and said, man, you sitting with this crowd, these lowlifes, these roughnecks, but God is exhibiting his attitude. I want a relationship with them. Praise God, Jesus could identify with a sinner. You know why? Because he had to identify with me. Praise God, Jesus knocked on my door. Praise God, Jesus sat at my table. Praise God. Jesus reasoned with me to come out of darkness into the marvelous light. Praise God. Jesus said to me, come ye all that are labored and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Praise God. Jesus said to me, come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as lamb's wool. Praise God. Jesus found me when I was down and out. Praise God. Jesus found me when I had lost hope. Praise God. That he wants to have a relationship with me. I'll be honest, when I was out there, I didn't have a good relationship with myself. Lost, dead, hurt, wounded, had no identity, but Christ put it all back together. Anybody in here can say, Christ put me all back together? The world couldn't do it, but Jesus did. Here we are, back again, where we was last Sunday. We covered four principles of repentance. Here we are again. Let me take you through the first four real quickly. Number one, if you're going to turn around, repentance is a gift from God. There's no natural inclination for you to repent. You just don't happen one day just because you bump your head or you hit rock bottom. You're going to repent. The Holy Spirit has to convict you. The Bible says of sin. You realize that you're going in the wrong direction, but that ain't what you realize by yourself. You was lost, but now you've been found. You was blind, but now you see. You see because God shined the light on your soul. Are you with me here? Repentance is not a single act, but an ongoing attitude or continual attitude. Every now and then or every day, You can repent. Touch your neighbor and say, you can continue to repent. You ain't got to stay there. You ain't got to wallow there. You ain't got to soak up all that dust. You ain't got to stay there. You can't turn it around. Are you with me here? Number three, repentance is not merely, repentance is turning not merely from what you have done, but from who you are. Repentance is repenting from the sin and repenting from the fact that we are sinners saved by grace. What are we? Sinners saved by grace. Repentance, number four, is not what you do for yourself. It's what God does for you. Your mind says, I want to change. Your heart says, I want to change. But the hand of God makes the real difference in your life. You ain't walking right because of some aestheticism, because you've got a new discipline or a new resolution today. You walking right because Christ has done something in your life. Now let me get to these last three. Plus one for me. You ready? Repentance deals not merely with the fruit of sin, but the root of sin. If we only repent from merely the fruit of sin, the root will continue to produce the same old problem in our lives. May not come this year, may not come next year, but 5 years down the line, it comes back up. You got to repent of who you are. Have I got somebody? Some of us will confess we lied, but we won't say we're lying. You do know I have some liars in the church. Give me a little bit more volume. There's some liars in the church. Have I got somebody? They got a lying problem in the church. Anything will come out their mouths. Sometimes we got to repent of being a liar. Say amen if you can. You know why folk complain and murmur in the church? Because of the spirit of unbelief. They start focusing on the church and the people and not focusing on God. That's why we can have a beautiful program. Here come your nitpickers that can pick out the littlest thing in the program, because their eyes are not on Jesus, their eyes on us. And you know, black folk got a problem. They think black folk can't do nothing right. So it validates that little old belief in them that we can't do nothing right. But those of us who walk by faith and not by sight, those of us whose trust is not in our ability, but whose trust is in our God, we serve an awesome God. And every Sunday I come to church, I don't care if the lights don't work, I serve an awesome. I wish I had help right here. I serve an awesome God. I don't care how you sing, I serve an awesome God. We too focus on people and not focus on God. Number six, I'm moving right along. Repentance is not a secret, but open. Sometimes we first of all, we repent toward God first and foremost. But sometimes we need to go repent to our brother, because we know we backstabbed him, talked about him, put him down. We mad at our sister because she got a new hairdo, or she's smiling too much. I got on a pretty dress with some sassiness with it. Come on, say amen. We all upset trying to figure out what she's so happy about. We done ran her down all over the church and folk don't even know her. Oh, come on, say amen. You need to tell God you sorry, and you need to tell her you sorry. Number seven, we going home here. Number seven, you repent for both the negative and the positive. You know what you used to do? You know where you used to hang? You know how you used to cut up? Oh, come on, say amen. You know, you got a reputation for doing your thing. They got a name for you out in the street. Oh, come on, say amen. But now God has changed your life. You're not doing what you used to do. Not because you can't do it no more. You still can shake your thing. You still can cut up. But you got a new agenda now. You're going to do some good for God. Have I got a witness in this place? You're going to shout for God. Have I got a witness in this place? You're going to turn the lights on for God. I got one more. One more. Repentance makes it right with God. The works of repentance truly belongs to God. He alone made grace available for the undeserved. Hallelujah. He alone provided a sacrifice for sinners at Calvary's Hill that served to satisfy God's justice for all men. No religious act, no works will make it acceptable or get you into the kingdom. No membership at any church, no matter how long your robe is or how long your dress is. Only the repentant heart who aligns itself up with the power of God can be saved from all sin, shame, and degradation. Proverbs 21:3 says, to do righteousness and justice is more acceptable to the Lord than any sacrifice. No sacrifice I can ever present to God is better than a repentant heart. Are you with me here? God desires to have an intimate relationship with you and I. Are you with me here? He wants to know you in a personal way. But you got to break up with yourself. Touch your neighbor and say, you got to break up with yourself. You got to quit the world and your old ways and put God first. Have I got somebody? Hosea 6:6 says, for I desire mercy and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God more than a burnt offering. Are you with me here? Your opportunity is only for a while. While his love is available, while his mercy is abundant, while his arms are stretched wide open, while his voice is still calling you. Isaiah 55:6 says, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his ways. One thing I found about Jesus, Jesus is everything that you need. Have I got a witness here? For Adam, he was his covering for nakedness. For Abel, he was his consuming fire for his sacrifice. For Noah, he was a rainbow hung in the sky. For Abraham, he was a sacrificial lamb. For Isaac, he was his well. For Jacob, he was his ladder. For Judah, he was a scepter. For Joseph, he was his dream. But for Moses, he was a lawgiver. For Joshua, he was a battle axe. For David, he was his shepherd. For Isaiah, he was his vision. For Jeremiah, he was that fire shot up in his bone. For Ezekiel, he was a wheel in the middle of a wheel. For Daniel, he was a keeper in the lion's den. But for me, child of God, Jesus is a mother when you're motherless. He's a father when you're fatherless. He's a friend when you're friendless. He's a rock in a weary land, a shelter in a time of storm. My daddy would say he's a lily of a valley, bright and morning star. He's the rose of Sharon. Hey, he's the lover of my soul. Jesus is my great physician. Do you know him? Have you tried him? Isn't he all right? Shout yes.
Thank you. I hope the days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you wanted. Till your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same things too. Yeah, this is my wish. I hope you never look back, but you never forget all the ones who love you in the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake, and always give more than you take, but more.